Yeah.
Everybody, how is everybody today? Listener, have I told you lately that I love you? Well, I love you. Well, you notice how Ella's talking a little bit like a crapo? I get in the flu. You know, this usually happens when the kids go back out to school. They pick up things, they bring it back home, they share it. And so something was shared to me and it's the flu. But you know something, I just have a feeling that the school will call me today and someone come and pick up the elder ducklings, because they really try to put up a brave front. They really try to make it to school this morning, and they love school. That's one thing I can boast about, they love school. But I find like they still weren't 100, so I told them it's okay. Tell the teacher, call mommy, and I'll come pick them up. However, my intention today, well, since yesterday, I want to do something nice today. Right? Now, when you want to do something nice, you have to understand that it doesn't take a lot. It doesn't take a lot. And some people do it on a larger scale. Some people do it on a very tiny scale. Whatever scale you do it on, what is most important is the condition of your heart when you're doing it, right? If you're giving with a willing heart and a happy heart, then that is what is going to trigger blessings to flow and flow and flow. And when the blessings flow, they flow not only through you, but through the people who you help. And then they in turn can pay it forward. So, you know, it's a cycle. And I want to keep the cycle going today. Someone sent a whole set of bodhi for me a little while ago. I cooked some, but how much bodhi I could eat for myself, right? The girls ate, it was delicious. We ate bodhi for like 2 days straight, and I just found like this bodhi kept multiplying in my fridge. So I cut it up, and I cut up a chicken, seasoned it up. What I'm going to do is just like cook a little lunch, and I'm not even going in the grocery to buy a set of things. I have some soft drink. I got some soft drink, and I buy some Kiss goodies. They have a offer. I think it's 10 for $8 or 8 for $10. But I buy a couple packs of those. So my intention is to cook a little curry stew body with some coconut milk and rice, and slice up some bananas, put together a few boxes of lunch, maybe 10 or so. And I'm gonna ask Miss Allison, I'm gonna pick up Miss Allison, she coming online with me, we'll drink some tea, we'll all talk, we'll prepare the boxes, and then we'll go and distribute them. But you know, obviously I won't take you all with me to show you who I'm giving it to. Mm-mm, you don't do that. I just wanted to do this to show you all how much fun it could be just to put a few boxes of something together and be happy doing it. Be happy doing it. You know, it should never have to be that you're doing it and say, oh gosh, well, I have to cut up all this bodhi, and I had to cut up this chicken and wash this chicken and season this chicken and boil rice and straighten. No. Do it like this. Yeah, I'm going to cut up some bodhi day. Or you say, yeah boy, this chicken, I could cut up and wash this. I could do with cutting up a chicken and washing a chicken today. Right? Yeah boy, let me boil some rice. You know? Just put a positive spin on everything that you're doing. And, you know, let the negativity fall away. Let the negativity fall away from your ears. Don't pay attention to what's going on there. Pay attention to what's going on inside here. Right? That's the key. That's the key. What's inside here what's inside here between you and the Almighty God, that's the most important. And you will see joy and happiness abundantly, you know. But I feel like I had to go and get some coconut water or some orange juice or something, boy, because this flu is trying to take me down, but I won't let it. So going in the grocery, I just had to get a few spoons or forks or spokes, and I'm not going and overdo it, because I'm just going to use what I have. And that, at the end of the day, that is really what it's supposed to be about. You use what you have, give up what you have, and you will see. When you start to go through your fridge and you start to go through your cupboards and you realize, I could put some things together, you would start to feel so motivated. It is going to become like a challenge for you, a real good challenge. All right, let's go inside our cupboard today and see what we could make. Sometimes when I make sandwiches for the girls to take to school, I make like about three extra, stop along the way, buy three chubbies, and I always find people to give a meal to. So what they will be getting today is a nice little package, a nice delicious box of food, a good helping. Don't mind, the boxes will be looking small. They'll get a soft drink, a water, a kiss cake, and I don't know, I think I have some snacks there. Maybe like a little potato chips or something. We're going and treat them good. Okay, I had a coma here better when I go home. But look who with me this morning, my friend.
Hey,
it's Miss Allison, my friend.
Yes.
So she coming to help me home. Yes. We'll drink a little coffee, yes, and she will go with me down the road when we go in to drop it off and stuff.
Yes.
And give my box a gift. Yeah. They're my friend, you know. They're my real friend, Miss Allison. Plenty people ask me. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Thanks to everybody that sent help for me.
Yes.
And thanks for everything. And bless my dog and them all. They send dog chow for one.
Thanks
everything.
For all the help that
that I get right through.
Yeah. God bless all you.
Yes.
God bless all you.
And may Yahweh always big up all who send.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Oh God. Well, let me go up the road
and do some cooking.
Cooking. And drink some coffee. So let me show all you the situation home here today, right? My friend Allison helping me wash up the seasonings and thing, and we have some bananas. We'll slice some of the tomatoes. Sarita said bananas, so we just call it bananas too. Right, so we'll slice up some of the bananas
and put it
as a little salad at the side
and the food.
I put the soft drinks to chill already in the freezer.
So they will
get it cold. Yeah. And I have a big rice pot with salted water waiting to come up to a boil.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Let me flip. Alright, so we sipping with tea and thing, you know. We sipping with tea and thing. I don't wash the rice to put in there. I have a body already cut up, right? I want to say thanks to the person who had sent in the body. I didn't get the name of the person who sent in the body, but thank you very much. Look at where your hard work going. I have the chicken already seasoned up. Yeah, man, let's go feed 10 people comfortable, right?
Yeah.
There is curry, salt, black pepper, oyster sauce, and some Maggi cubes in there. And then when Miss Allison blend up the seasoning, we'll throw some of the green seasoning inside there. Yeah. Check how meticulous this lady is now. She washing careful, you know. Everything.
And taking out all the dirt.
Oh gosh, thanks Miss Allison. I could work with you in our kitchen, girl.
Yeah.
I go hire you.
Yes. Nice. I hope you didn't understand.
Yeah. She said when I open my big restaurant. All right. 8 for 10. Remember, I was trying to remember if it was 10 for 8 or 8 for 10. It's 8 for 10. So we have some of this situation here. And watch me. People getting dinner mint and thing, you know. Right? They ain't getting any ordinary dinner mint. They're getting honey and lemon. And they're getting snacks as well. I'm a big pot waiting there, and that is the situation in Ellie's kitchen.
And the cold juice.
And the cold juice. Yes, the cold cokes. Well, I went in the grocery and somebody buy this. Because I tell them I had a few home and I was going to buy it, and they said they wanted to sponsor it, so they sponsored it for us. And it's going to go a very long way. Thank you very much to that person. They wish to remain anonymous. It seems like the theme for today is honey, because we have some honey and lemon
and
mints,
honey.
Right? And then we have Alice, right? I'm joking.
Yeah.
And then I want to show all you something real interesting. We have some honeycomb. I will flip the camera and give all you a close-up shot, right? But this is where honey comes from, right? Oops. This is real honey.
Yes.
Right? Real capped honey from a real honeycomb with real beeswax. Let me flip it to show all you a better situation. Where's that, Allison? Where's that?
I said, so it wouldn't bite their lip. They have to know what they're doing, so it wouldn't bite their lip.
Yeah. If you've never seen a honeycomb up close, well, you're in for a real treat. All right? What happens is that a beekeeper will have an apiary. He will have boxes, bee boxes, and he will insert a frame. This is a frame, all right? This is a frame, and on the frame, he would run some wires going horizontal. See any wires there? Right? And he will then insert it. Hold on. The wax kind of sticking onto the basin, right? He will insert it like this into the boxes, right? So you see the little edges there? That's gonna fit and hang in the bee boxes real good. So there'd be a few of these frames in each box, and what will happen is that the bees will come and they will start building the honeycomb. And if you look at each cell, you'd realize that it's a hexagon, right? Perfect engineering, perfect design, and they will start producing honey. They will go fly off, get their nectar, bring it back into the hive, fill up the cells with honey, and then when each cell is filled, they will cap it. All right, they will cap it, meaning they will cover it with a thin film of wax. Now, how do you know when your honey is ready to be harvested? What happens is that the thin layer of wax will actually have like a sucked in situation. So you see how it looks as if it's actually going into the cell? All right, that means that the honey is ripe and ready for harvesting, or else it would be just, you know, puffed up over the cells. So, honeycomb. I got this from Uncle Frank and Auntie Allie, and this is a real treat because this is real beeswax. Real beeswax. So I will tell you something about Ellis, right? That I bet you didn't know. Ellis is a qualified and registered beekeeper. I was registered and qualified about 18 years ago, but I just never had the time or the space to actually set up a hive or set up an apiary. A good friend actually introduced me to beekeeping many, many years ago, and from the time I entered the hive for the first time, it was magical. It was wonderful, and I always enjoy looking at bees, looking at how they come and they collect pollen, and they'd go into the flowers and extract the nectar and fly away. And bees are so interesting. Maybe later on I'll be able to tell you a bit more. And you know when a bee flies around you, your first instinct would be to like that? No, don't do that. When you start to flail up like that, that's when you're increasing the risk of getting stung. So if a bee comes around you, I know it's going to be very, very nerve-wracking. Dig from deep within and just stay still. And they'll fly away because Them not on you. I'm looking for nectar. I'm looking to go back to the hive, you know? So. Mmm. Yes, man. Nice, fresh, green
this
seasoning.
Tomato, eh?
In a basin. Mm-hmm. So we throw in directly into the chicken and letting it sit for like a 10 minutes. Giving them real seasoning. One thing, when it is your cooking to share and to distribute, to share a meal with anybody, what I like to do is that I always cook in a way that I know me and my family would enjoy, right? I don't take any shortcuts. I prepare it exactly the same way I would cook for my family. That's the only way. That's the only way to cook. You know, I know you're probably doing that too, but you know, never hurts to just reiterate. Yes, man. So the chicken nice and seasoned up with all sorts of yummy stuff. We'll leave it to hang out for 10 minutes. And in the meantime, my friend here, Miss Allison,
yes,
is slicing up the tomatoes. Do you want the chopping board?
On the side, eh?
You want to slice it on the board?
Yeah, give me the board. No, I'm good on this.
Miss Allison says she like that knife day, boy.
Yes.
You watch now.
And
she real slicing it nice, eh?
And neat.
Use a real tomato slicing friend.
Yes.
Eh, look, we have a honeybee here too, boy.
Yes, I too.
Honey everywhere.
Yeah.
Oh gosh, but like they put on makeup for the honeybee. Alright, you relax yourself, they partner. Right. Right, so we just shifted the pot rice boiling away. Just has a few minutes again. Alright. And we put up a big pot situation here. Right? We heavy duty situation. And it's going to be curry stew. So when I put the oil inside there, I'll put the sugar to brown. And I will chunk the chicken with the curry. Let that cook halfway and then we'll throw in the body. And Miss Allison has such delicate hands. It's almost as if she's doing a tomato dance inside there. Layering the slices ever so gently, ever so lovingly. Thank you, Miss Allison. So I threw in a little bit of oil inside there and I will average is, I think is about four pounds of chicken. So I'll put like 4 tablespoons of sugar inside there and let this caramelize. I'm giving them full fire. Yes, man. Look how nice and fluffy. And caramelize it coming. I just wanted to go a little more amber. And then we'll throw in the chicken. Yeah, that's a day, man. Now be careful when you chunk in. Do it with one hand. Right. And now. Don't turn it up too much. Right? Now, let me tell you something. Well, they might say that's too much a stew for that little bit of chicken. But remember, we have body going inside there. So I made provision for that too. Because we want the body to get a nice stew curry flavor also, eh? Yes, lovely, lovely color. So in go the body pieces, man. Yes. And we're mixing up everything. Don't mind the pot's a little shaky. My hand's sturdy, right? Equilibrium. Tighten that core and turn that pot. Tighten that core and turn the pot. Yes, boy. Ooh, that's smelling good. I wish you all could be smelling this, you know. Right, time to strain that rice.
Yes,
So we just pulling up with little spokes, with little napkin situation. Yeah, Allison doing it better than me. I don't know how to fold fork and thing. I only believe I could cook, but I don't know how to fold napkin and fork. Look at how neat Miss Allison doing it.
Yes, sure.
Way a shame.
Oh, Lord.
So I tasted the sauce. It just needed a little adjustment for salt. And the chicken is cooked perfectly. The body is nice and tender. This is so flavorful. My mouth watering. Right? And I'm just gonna throw in some coconut milk. What I did is just simply dissolve 2 packs of coconut milk powder. And I'll just let this cook down for a few more minutes again here. Let the sauce thicken up a bit. And then we'll start to dish out any boxes. And put the little.
You're not waiting for it to cool.
No, we ain't waiting for nothing to cool. We're carrying it hot.
Let it eat it hot.
They gotta blow it. That is how we want them eating it. They had to blow it.
Yes.
Right. So ready to dish out, Miss Allison.
Yes.
And the rice here, nice and hot and ready and waiting. Mm-hmm. Let me see if I can see that steam. Will you see that steam? Mm-hmm. Hot on the spot by Ellis. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right, so we have the boxes of food all prepared. We'll close them up, bag them out, put the snacks in it.
Piece by piece.
Piece by piece, and we will head down the road. Alright, so we put in a box of food. Right. A goodie. Right. A salty snack.
Yes.
Anna. Mint. Yes. And one of the spoons.
Right.
And we repeat several times. Miss Allison, tell me, I had to try one of this because
it isn't good.
It isn't good?
Yes.
One of the honey. Let me show you. Mentor Max honey and lemon with vitamin C. This is exactly.
And it tastes good.
It tastes good?
Yes. And it's going down good too.
You know what I forget to show them? Oh. I forget to cut the honeycomb to show all you.
How it is, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, Miss Allison.
Sweating, you're sweating like a puppy.
We had to stop and make a chubby in this heat, girl.
Yeah.
If I told all you what's happening in Cora right now, real action. Bushfire. I see the forestry people. We actually finished. Exactly at midday, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we load up.
Yes, and we're ready to roll.
We're ready to roll. We're heading down, and we'll see if I get a safe spot, and I will probably if I could show you the smoke on the mountains and things.
Yes.
Hey, you're probably my head blinking.
Yeah,
my head blinking. Crazy, it's blinking. So I just stopped along the Cora Royal Road, and if you see something like snow falling, that's not snow, that's ash from the bushfire, because I've stopped at a good location where you could actually see what's going on the hills. And I must say, I must commend the forestry workers, because I had barely started seeing smoke on the mountains when the full crew, yeah, all right. Yeah, when the full crew came up and they started organizing, as we like to say in Trinidad, they started gazing up and they heading inside there to work hard. Let's lift them up in prayer. Let's lift them up in prayer and ask the Lord to, protect them and guide them and bring them back out safely. So you see, look at that. It's a lot of bushfire actually. Right now you're just seeing like the canopy, you're just seeing the smoke coming out from the hills there. But if you see this in real, if you hear it in real, I'm hearing the crackling sounds, the singeing sounds going on. Smoke going up all up there.
I really hope them fellas go in and come back out safely. Miss Allison and I are happy to report we had great success.
Sharing on these lunches.
Yeah, the boxes of food were well received with such happy faces, yes, and stuff. And, you know,
some people that really wanted it.
Yeah, they needed it. And we did it just in time.
Yeah.
That we were able to pick up Suri because her school finished just at the exact time when we got through with everything. Yes.
So, timing.
Yeah. So what we're going to do is we have a little time to kill. You'll just sit down and chill and relax a little bit. And then we'll pick up the other ducklings.
Yes.
Where's Allison?
Yes, with me.
I drink my juice and I eat all my lunch and I drink all my water.
You eat all your lunch and drink all your water? That is fantastic. I'm so proud of you. Let me see the muscles. Whoosh! I'd like very much to show you all something, right? There is an iguana on the wall, looking right there, sprawled like now. And on top of the roof was a mockingbird trying to grab him and carry him away, probably to feed the rest of the family. Well, watch now. Check out Mr. Man. Here now. He's just breezing right there, you know. I wish the bird could come back so that y'all could see the drama that was going on. The bird must have tried about a dozen times to grab this iguana in its talons. But Mr. Iguana, hold on for dear life. I don't know. If he get super suction power on his toes and legs, but he did not let go. Let me see if while I'm standing here speaking with you, if one of those beautiful birds will come in the background and feed. I just wash and refill the feeders, and the day went so exceptionally well. It was such a fantastic day. I'm so happy that I got through with everything that I set out to do today. The only thing is that this flu creeping up on me, and I'm heading inside to make a little bush tea situation. But I just remembered that I didn't cut open the honeycomb for you to see inside. How can I do that to you? I can't do that to you. Nah, Ellis had to fix that. But before I go inside, let me just put it all together properly. I'll just cut some of the fever grass. And boil just enough for tonight, yes? Tomorrow I could do a whole pot and sip on that all day. Right, so this will be enough for 2 cups, and when I cut the honeycomb, I will sweeten my fever grass tea with the honey from the comb. Yes, this looking like one of the ducklings working out. You ever see fever grass being bottle cork? Well, you see it live and direct here first on Ella's food and more. Ella's going and fix that one time. Let me flip. So, honeycomb made from beeswax, therefore heat will melt it. Okay, this is a little trick. Let your knife heat up a bit in some warm water. Bring your honeycomb. Maybe I'll do this side. Okay, so you see all this honey inside there is nice and ripe and capped. So take out your knife, pat dry the excess water off, and just run your knife gently along the top of the piece of wire like that. You see how nice and easy it cuts in. And at the bottom of the wire too. Yeah, now I hope I'm doing this thing properly, you know. Yep. On the bottom of the wire there. Okay, put back the knife to heat
and we'll repeat at the bottom here. Okay, part two. Look at that, honeycomb, y'all. Look at that. And what you could do as well is just gently take the knife and uncap that there. Wow, look at that, nice honey. Let's see if I could zoom in a little more for y'all. Right now, newer wax tends to be lighter in color, like this portion here. That's newer wax, right? The older wax will be a bit darker. So what will happen is that when the beekeeper uncaps the honey, he will put it into the extractor drum, extract the honey, and what will happen is that because of the centrifugal motion, all the honey is gonna fly out from the center of the barrel where the frame is located and hit the sides of the barrel. And there's a tap at the bottom of the barrel that you could open and drain on your honey. What you're gonna find happening too is that now you're gonna have a frame with honeycomb and all the honey is extracted. So you could just take this frame right back and put it, considering you didn't cut it up, take it right back into the hive, which is how you'll end up with a darker colored honeycomb. All right. Listen now, while we here, let me drink some bush tea. Let's drink some nice fever grass tea. Yeah. We need back that strainer. We'll get rid of the strainer just yet. What I'll do, I'll take a piece of that honeycomb and just see if I can give all that a good shot. Just squeeze it right in there. Mmm. And yes, the honeycomb is safe to chew up in your mouth. And then, I mean, you wouldn't swallow the wax, right? Don't do that, please. Spit it out after you've sucked out all the honey from it. Think again, nice teaspoon of honey from this.
When I first started to train as a professional beekeeper, guess what? Ellis was allergic to honey, right? Don't laugh, I used to eat the honey, I used to drink the honey, and I would throw up, I'd get itchy, and my tongue would get all swollen. One of the professionals from the beekeepers group advised me to put myself through a desensitizing course. So I was like, well, where to go and sign up for that, and where do I register and whatnot? And everybody started laughing. I couldn't understand why these people laughing at me. All it means is that every day, what I was required to do is just dip my finger in the honey and taste it, and let my body become accustomed to the honey gradually. It started with one finger dip, and then two, three. Eventually I worked myself up to a teaspoon and then a tablespoon. Man, now I'm drinking honey with straw and thing, man. You know? So you might want to be careful if you have not been exposed to honey at all or within recent years. Be careful. Alright. So let me show you something. I mean, how are you gonna have honeycomb and not take a little bite? Mm-hmm. Wow, that's sweet. That is some beautiful natural organic honey straight from the apiary, directly from the apiary. Thank you, Uncle Frank and Auntie Allie. Right, and this is the chewed up beeswax. You all will see me walking around a lot. That's because I wiping and stuff now. Multitasking. This is what Ellis does. But because the evening is so nice, walk outside with me again, huh? One more time for the day. Just one more time for the day. While I sit down and drink my bush tea. Right. The taste of the honey will differ according to the location of an apiary. Not every single bottle of honey will taste the same. There was this individual in the Beekeepers Association. His name was Elvis Jagbadansing, and he was a real professional beekeeper. Unfortunately, he's passed on, and that man could have just tasted one drop of honey, and he would list off all the different types of trees that the bees would have foraged on. That a taste there, now I ain't reached to that level yet, but that a taste there, it was a taste of something like a tonka bean and a little molasses aftertaste. I don't know, I'm gonna have to double check that with Uncle Frank, and I'll let you all know subsequent to this video what the bees might have foraged on. If flowers are scarce, what a beekeeper does is that he will actually go and put liquid feed in the hive for the bees to feed off of, and that can also alter the taste of the honey. But I know this evening, whatever the bees foraged on, it is to my delight. Thank you very much for spending a portion of the day with me. I know I'm not looking 100%. I'm fighting this virus with everything in me, plus some bush tea and honey. So until next time, be happy, be safe. I love you. I love you, love you, love you, love you. I love all of all you. I would have sent a bar, but material spill, right? So
let me do it for you.
Bye. You see? You see the joys of having backup? See, this is a bar, right? Take care. Yeah. Feeling better already. Feeling better already. Just smelling it alone. It's like, uh-oh. Uh-oh. I don't know if you all could see that. Well, I know you're seeing the smoke, right? But I don't know if you can see the flames. Look at how far the bushfire reached. Literally right opposite the ridge, right opposite to our home. You know? I can actually see the yellow and orange glow of the fire. You might get a little peep of it in between the leaves there. But you see how far this thing reach? Way. And that fire spread from over this ridge, which would be on the opposite side of this ridge, I believe is like more the Tacarigua area side there. Yeah. Yep. Oh, I hope those guys are okay.